Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Art Gallery of Ontario's virtual programs. We're going to begin today with a land acknowledgement. A land acknowledgement shares information about the land on which the Art Gallery of Ontario is built, as well as the Indigenous people whose territory it is. The land the Art Gallery of Ontario is on is Michisagig Anishinaabe Territory, Mississauga. It is also governed by a treaty between the Mississauga of the Credit and the Canadian government. Toronto is Michisagig Anishinaabe Territory. It has also been occupied by other Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and Wendat confederacies. This is the Art Gallery of Ontario in downtown Toronto. Some of you may have visited the building before. Some of you may visit the building in the future. My name is Laboni, and I am currently in the city of Toronto, but I would love to know where in the world you are. So please let me know by putting your location in the Q&A. You can also have an adult help you type your response. Wonderful. We have some participants from Belleville, North York, Sudbury, Ottawa, downtown Toronto. Let's see from where in the world other people are participating. Brampton. Wonderful. It's great to have participants from so many different places. Well, the theme for today's session is art and the senses. Now, when I say the word senses, what does that actually mean to you? You can put your ideas in the Q&A. What do I mean by the senses? And let's see what people's ideas are. While we wait for those to come in, I see that Rawlinson from Toronto is with us. Here we have a response. So somebody says that the senses include seeing, tasting, and listening, eyes, and nose. Thank you very much. Those are great responses. You know, there are many ways of experiencing the world. Some of the ways people experience the world are by seeing, by hearing or listening, by smelling, by tasting, and by touching different surfaces. So today what we're going to do is explore two works of art together. We're going to talk a little bit about how they can connect to the senses. We're also going to do some activities together. And even though we're not all together in the same room, I really want this to feel like a conversation. So every now and then, I am going to ask you questions. And you or your adult can type your answers in the Q&A. Let's begin. Here is our first work of art. It's a painting. Let's look at this painting from top to bottom and side to side. How do you feel when you look at this painting? Please put your answers in the Q&A. I see some answers coming in. So somebody feels calm. Somebody else feels energized. Someone else feels peaceful. A couple people feel peaceful, joyful. Oh, somebody says it feels like they are right there. Someone feels good, relaxed. That's wonderful. You know what's really neat? What's neat is that we can all look at this painting, but everyone's going to feel something a little bit different. For example, one person felt really calm, but another person felt very, very energized. It's funny, when I look at this painting, I actually feel a little bit lonely. I don't know why. I'm imagining myself standing on the grass with these tall, tall trees above me, and their treetops are so high that I couldn't touch them. And maybe that's why. And there's nobody else. There are no people shown in the painting. So maybe that's why it makes me feel a little bit lonely. Okay, next question. When you look at this painting, what colors stand out to you? Please put your answers in the Q&A. Somebody sees blue and blue-green. That's one of my favorite colors. I love blue-green. What other colors do you see? Somebody sees some black. Wonderful. I don't know whether you'll be able to see it where you are or on your screen, but I also notice some wavy bands of purple in the sky. It's hard to see, but there is a little bit of purple there too. Somebody sees brown. Oh, very good. Somebody sees cool colors. That's excellent. So the colors that really stand out to me in this painting are blue and green. There's a little bit of purple too. And sometimes we call blue, green, and purple cool colors because they have a cool temperature. They may remind you of the water or even snow or ice. Next question. When you look at this painting, what do you notice in the painting? What's in the scene? Please put your answers in the Q&A. Oh, the answers are coming in. So people see trees, mountains, nature. Yes, there's a lot of nature. The sky. Oh, somebody sees a pathway. Branches. The grass. Birds. A rainforest. Texture in waves. That's wonderful. Thank you for your responses. I notice many of the same things that you notice. I see a large blue sky. I see some green and yellow-green grass. I see some hills in the distance, and it looks like the hills may be covered with forest and trees. I also see some really, really tall trees with thin trunks. And on the ground, I also see some tree stumps and some broken parts of trees. And that makes me really wonder, what happened here? Now, this painting is an example of representational art. Representational is a fancy word that just means that the artist put things in the painting that people can recognize, like the sky, the grass, trees, and hills. Now, if you were the artist and you could create your own title for this painting, what would you call it? Please put your answers in the Q&A. Oh, I see some answers coming in. Somebody would call this painting calming. Another person would call it the forest. Oh, another person would call it the secret garden. Nature life. Mother Nature's world. Chopped down trees. Thank you for that idea. I'm going to come back to that idea a little bit later on. Somebody would call this weirdness. Black flying trees. Thank you for all your ideas. Those are so imaginative. Oh, here's another one. The life of a tree. Wow, the life of a tree. I'm going to come back to that idea a little later on. Let's remember it. This painting is called Trees in the Sky, and it was made about 80 years ago in the year 1939 by a Canadian artist named Emily Carr. Now, Emily Carr was living in British Columbia at the time when she made this painting. And she loved trees. She loved the forest. She loved drawing and painting while in the forest. But there was something that was happening at the time when she was making this painting. Somebody mentioned earlier that they would call this painting chopped down trees. And that's exactly what was happening. Many, many trees were being chopped down because people wanted to use the wood for different purposes. Emily Carr felt very unhappy about this. So she actually made some paintings that show the land or the landscape with these chopped down trees. But she also showed us some tall, tall trees that are still very much alive. And I tried to count them. I think there's 19 or 20 super tall trees in this painting. I want to come back to an idea that somebody mentioned before. Somebody said that they would call this painting the life of a tree. I thought that was really interesting because it connects to the story being shown in the scene. We have trees that are growing super, super tall, and they're healthy, and they're thriving. And then we have some trees that have been chopped down. So the painting is telling us a story in a way. Now, we're going to do a little activity to use one of our other senses, and that's listening and hearing. I want you to imagine that you are actually inside this painting. Imagine that you're inside the scene. What are some sounds that you might hear in your environment? You can put your ideas in the Q&A. Birds chirping. A chainsaw. Wow. The wind. That's wonderful. Birds flying. Absolutely. You might hear their flapping. Crickets. I love that. I want you to imagine one sound in your mind. Imagine it very, very clearly. I have my sound. I hope you have yours. On the count of three, we're going to make our sound together quietly. One, two, three. Whoosh. Very good. Now we're going to try to create a soundscape together, which means we're going to work together to make some sound effects for this painting. I am going to lead you like a conductor. If I give you two thumbs up, that means start making your sound. If I raise my hands like this, that means make your sound louder. If I lower my hands like this, that means make your sound quieter. And if I put my finger to my lips like this, that means stop making your sound. Are you ready? I'm going to make my sound with you. Even though we cannot hear one another, we can imagine. On the count of three, one, two, three. Whoosh, 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 whoosh. Very good. Thank you for participating with me. Now, let's look at our next work of art. Whoa! This is also a painting, and this painting is very different from the painting that we just saw. When you look at this painting, how does it make you feel? Please put your answers in the Q&A. Ooh, somebody says it makes them feel speedy, happy, strong, cool, excited. You know what? This painting makes me feel energized. Somebody else feels energized too. We used the exact same word to describe our feelings. That's wonderful. Next question. When you look at this painting, what colors do you notice? What colors stand out to you? Please put your answers in the Q&A. Oh, the answers are coming in. A lot of red. What other colors stand out to you? Warm colors, thank you. I'm going to come back to that idea. Orange. Very good. Yellow. Those are the colors that stand out to me as well. I see a lot of red. There's a lot of orange and yellow. I don't know whether you can see it on your screen, but do you see the gray part towards the bottom of the painting? If you look closely at that area, there are actually some light blue lines. They're very, very straight, and they're a pale blue. They're difficult to see from a distance, but if you look close, you may find them too. Now, somebody mentioned warm colors. Thank you for sharing that idea. Sometimes we call red, orange, and yellow warm colors because they have a warm temperature. They may remind you of the sun or fire. Now, this painting is an example of abstract art. Abstract is a fancy word that just means that the artist used lines and shapes and colors to create a painting. But different people will see different things in this painting. We can use our imagination to decide what we feel and see, because it doesn't include things that people can recognize, like trees and hills and grass. So when you look at this abstract painting, what do you see? And you can use your imagination. Put your answers in the Q&A. Ooh, somebody sees a road, a sunset, a beak. Somebody sees speed. I love that. What else do you see? A rainbow. Thank you for your ideas. You know what I see? I see a sunset over an empty road. The colors, red, orange, and yellow, also remind me of autumn, because in my neighborhood, so many of the trees, their green leaves have turned yellow and orange and red. If you were the artist, and you could create your own title for this painting, what would you call it? Please put your answers in the Q&A. Ooh, somebody would call it Flash. Trains zooming by. The sunset. Thank you for your ideas. This painting is called Tobori, and it was painted by a Quebecois Abenaki artist named Rita Latondra. Now, Rita Latondra took a really interesting approach to this painting because she wasn't using a paintbrush the way Emily Carr was using a paintbrush to paint her painting. Do you notice how the colors blend together? And there's some areas of the painting where it even looks soft or speckled and a little bit misty. That's because Rita Latondra used a special tool called an airbrush. So she put paint into a small container and sprayed it onto the surface of the canvas. And that is how she got this misty look and made the colors blend together beautifully. Now, if you look towards the bottom of the painting, do you notice those super straight lines? You know how she did that? She used some tape. She put tape along the canvas to make a straight line. So imagine that this is the tape stuck on the canvas. And then she sprayed the paint along the edge of the tape. The sprayed paint was able to stick to the canvas, but it couldn't go underneath the tape. So when she peeled off the tape, there was a straight line. It's a very, very creative approach. Rita Latondra loved color and light, and she was also really inspired by sound. She loves music, and she often listened to music while painting. So now we're going to do a little activity trying to combine sound and lines and color to make our own abstract art. I'm going to keep Rita Latondra's painting on screen just so we can be inspired. You're going to need a piece of paper and a pencil or a marker. Over here, I'm going to make myself a little larger so you can see me better. There you go. So this is what I'm going to do. I am going to make a sound. And by the way, if you don't have these materials with you right now, it's okay. You can listen to the instructions and you can do this activity on your own time whenever you like. So I am going to make some sounds. We're going to listen to the sound together and we're going to try to make a line on our paper that expresses the sound. Okay, so here we go. Here's the first sound. Ooh. Okay, I'm going to make the sound again, and let's imagine if that sound were a line, what would the line actually look like? There's no right or wrong answer. You use your imagination. Okay, so that's how the sound looks like to me as a line. I'm going to keep going. I'm going to make a few different sounds, and for each sound, I want you to make a line on your paper that expresses the sound. Remember, your lines can be straight, they can be curvy, they can be zigzaggy, whatever you like. But when you make the line, try to make it go from one side of the paper all the way to the other side. Are you ready? Here we go. Here's the next sound. Tucka, 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 tucka. Okay, I'm going to make the sound again, and I'm going to draw with you. Tucka, 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 tucka. Okay. I'm going to make one more sound. Here we go. Ooh. I'll make the sound again. And I'm going to make a line. Ooh. Very good. So now you probably have three very different lines going across your paper. Now, we're going to play with colors to color in different sections of our creation or our composition. You may want to experiment by using only cool colors like blue, green, and purple, or maybe you just want to use warm colors like red, orange, and yellow. Maybe you want to use all colors and mix them up. It's okay. Please use the colors that make you happy. I'm going to use some cool colors today. I have a nice blue marker. You can use marker. You can use pencil crayons or pastels, anything that you like. So I'm going to choose one section of my composition. I'm going to color it in. It's hard to color while I'm holding something up, but you get the idea. There we go. Okay. And I'm going to keep going until I color every single section of my creation or composition. But I'm going to give you one challenge when you're playing with colors. Here's another one that I was working on before. When you're using the color blue, for example, in two sections, so I've got blue over here and blue over here, try to make the two blue sections not be beside each other. They can be diagonal, they can touch each other at the corners, or they can be far apart from one another. Try to separate your colors and spread them out so we don't have the same blues right beside each other, or the same greens, or whatever color that you're using right beside each other. There you go. So you can continue working on your activity in your own time. And you know what? I believe that this Sunday is actually Rita Latondra's 92nd birthday. So maybe we can wish her a happy birthday by sharing our art. You can share your art at hashtag AGO schools. Thank you, everybody, for all of your participation today and for spending time with me. Please stay safe and stay creative. And I hope that one day we can meet one another at the Art Gallery of Ontario. Thank you.